lecture this morning will be given by Professor Gene Porter, John A. O'Brien, Professor of Theology here at Notre Dame. And her lecture is titled Justice as a Virtue of the Common Good. As Dr. Porter recounts from memory, when she turned 21, her friends gave her the Summa Theologia and a bottle of scotch. While I'm sure she made fine and temperate use of the scotch, she seems to have consumed the insights of Aquinas with far greater liberality. Her close reading of Aquinas offers a thoroughly contextualized and rich account of his moral and political thought. And while Aquinas figures centrally in both her historical and constructive work, there are two other important features of Dr. Porter's scholarship I'd like to highlight. First, Dr. Porter closely attends to Aquinas' scholastic interlocutors and contemporaries. She offers a retrieval not merely of Aquinas, but also of key features of late 11th to late 13th century scholastic thought more generally. Though this is most evident in her book, Natural and Divine Law, comprehensive attentiveness to this period of scholastic thought continues to inform her later constructive projects. Second, Dr. Porter moves fluidly between her historical scholarship and engagement with contemporary science and philosophy. Indeed, when responding to scientists and philosophers in interdisciplinary settings, she often surprises them by her detailed familiarity with their disciplines. If this piques your curiosity, you might look, for example, at Dr. Porter's response to Paul Bloom, a professor of cognitive science at Yale, at a 2013 symposium at the Center for Theological Inquiry. In her three most recent books, she develops constructive theological proposals by bringing scholastic thought into conversation with diverse fields of scholarship. In Nature as Reason, she develops a theory of natural law in dialogue with contemporary biologists and moral philosophers. In Ministers of the Law, she proposes a theory of legal authority that responds to and appropriates the best insights of 20th century jurisprudence. And in her most recent book, Justice as a Virtue, she insightfully expands on and illuminates the implications of Aquinas' views on justice for contemporary political philosophy. At a conference where the interests of the graduate students span these various disciplines and historical periods, we are very fortunate to have Dr. Porter join us to offer her most recent thoughts on the common good. Please join me in welcoming her.
I actually already have a mic. Oh.
Is that the
only for the recording then? So that's for the room. The other one's just for the recording.
All right. I have a very strong suspicion you're all going to be able to hear me.
All right.
Can you all hear me well enough back there? Yes. My voice would cut concrete. All right. Thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to the organizers of the conference, all of whom are I know in one context or another, and thank you all for your attendance. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to contribute to this conference. I want to apologize in advance that I can't attend very many of the sessions because of other commitments, but I'm happy to be able to be present to the extent that I can. And so with no further ado, and realizing that we want to have as much time as possible for conversation, let me turn directly to my paper. According to Aquinas, the common good is the formal object of a virtue, namely the virtue of general justice. It is difficult to know what to make of this claim. We are accustomed to think of the common good as a political or social ideal, to be pursued through collective political action. As for Aquinas himself, together with most of his interlocutors, the common good is a principle of legitimation, which justifies political rule and legislative authority. It is hard to see how a virtue-oriented analysis of the common good can add to our overall understanding of either a social ideal or a juridical political principle. There is something admittedly attractive about the ideal of the virtuous ruler, reliably guided in the exercise of rule by wisdom, informed by good and honorable motivations. But wise and virtuous sovereigns are not so common these days, and at any rate, this seductive ideal is very easily open to abuse. At any rate, Aquinas himself does not claim that virtues are sufficient or indeed necessary to guide public officials in the exercise of their duties. Bad men and women can act in accordance with political prudence and justice, even though they are neither wise nor just. Aquinas also claims that actions on behalf of the common good can only be carried out by those who hold public office, which both open up and constrain possibilities for action. When a political community is functioning in good order, its rulers and officials act in accordance with the duties and constraints that define their offices. We may reasonably expect that virtuous men and women will carry out their duties more conscientiously than those who are not so virtuous, but the point is that a well-conceived political system functions more or less independently of the personal qualities of the individuals who inhabit its roles. So we can set aside the worry, or perhaps the hope, that Aquinas holds out an ideal of wise, virtuous philosopher kings and queens in place of the functionaries who we know all too well. Aquinas and the scholastics generally are actually very much in favor of functionaries, living as they do in a society in which political rule, as opposed to the dominion of overlords, is still a relatively innovative and fragile achievement. I want to suggest that when Aquinas identifies the common good as the object of a particular virtue, he is not so much making a point about the qualifications for rule. Rather, he is making a point about the presuppositions and possibilities for the morally legitimate exercise of power. The point at stake is not so much that a good ruler must be a morally good person, but rather, and more fundamentally, that a good ruler can be a morally good person. Aquinas' claims about general justice and the common good presuppose the moral legitimacy of political rule and the possibility of living a virtuous life while holding public office. At the same time, his analysis of the common good as the object of a virtue is intertwined with his analysis of the common good as a principle of political legitimation. The moral possibilities for political action and public service presuppose the moral legitimacy of public rule and the institutions set up to carry it out. For this reason, reflection on general justice and its object, the common good, has something to teach us about the moral legitimacy of power and the conditions for exercising political authority in a morally admirable way. In my remarks this morning, I will set out the main lines of Aquinas' account of the common good and the virtue of general justice, focusing on the implications of this account for the moral possibilities of political rule. Along the way, I will also comment on what Aquinas says about the place of general justice in the lives of private citizens. Aquinas' remarks at this point might well strike us as inadequate, but as I will try to show, he does at least recognize that a good private citizen need not devote her whole life to the common good. In the case of both rulers and ruled, the common good is one out of an ensemble of good ends which are integrated into a well-lived human life, and the limited and contextual character of the common good is integrally connected to its soundness as a moral ideal. One's commitment to the common good, and by implication the common good itself, can only be understood and pursued in the context of other goods, which also have a claim on individuals and communities. And so I turn to the first section, general justice, particular justice, and the objects of justice, preliminary considerations. Before moving on, some clarifications are in order. Aquinas follows both Aristotle and his own immediate interlocutors in distinguishing between general and particular justice. This contrast might suggest that general justice refers to a general disposition towards goodness in general, rather than a distinct virtue, not so much a distinct virtue, therefore, as a quality or condition of all the virtues. In fact, both Aristotle himself and Aquinas' interlocutors interpret general justice in just this way, but Aquinas does not. Rather, he insists that general justice is a particular virtue with its own specific object, namely the common good. This is admittedly confusing on a first reading, or indeed from experience, a second or a third or many readings. in order to understand what Aquinas is saying, therefore, we need to place these remarks in some kind of context. Aquinas begins his treatment of justice, the virtue just considered as such, by citing Justinian's definition, a constant and perpetual will rendering to each that which is his right. This way of proceeding implies that justice is a specific virtue defined by its proper object, that is, the right. Reading further, we find that the virtue of justice is more complex, however. In his initial question on this virtue, he distinguishes between two kinds of justice, namely general or legal justice and particular justice, which pertains to the relations between individuals. Each of these is a distinctive virtue with its own proper object, respectively the common good and the right. Not only does he distinguish between general and particular justice, he also identifies that neither can be identified with virtue tout court. This can be confusing. General justice is a particular virtue, which is, however, distinct from particular justice, which is another particular virtue. But bear with me. When we place his account of general justice in the context of similar accounts offered by his interlocutors, we see why his terminology is so confusing. The theologians in the generation immediately prior to Aquinas, including Albert the Great and his early works, all agree that general justice is indeed equivalent to virtue comprehensively considered. At the same time, the traditional moral or cardinal virtues are typically identified as political virtues, which as such are ultimately oriented towards the good of the political community, in contrast to the theological or Catholic virtues, which are directed towards salvation. On this view, the good of the community is not only the highest humanly attainable good, it is the ultimate aim towards which all purely moral virtue is directed. Aquinas, in contrast, insists that general or legal justice is a specific virtue with its own object. Of course, this is confusing, but Aquinas cannot express himself in any other way if he wants to engage his own interlocutors. Nonetheless, he clearly says that general justice is a distinctive virtue and not virtuousness as such. Correlatively, and this I think is the main point for us today, the common good, important though it is not the defining object of moral virtue. Other virtues have their own distinct proper objects, and Aquinas does not identify any one super virtue, which is identified with virtue as such. How then does he relate the common good to the good aims that define the other virtues? He grants that general or legal justice can be identified with virtue as such, as his predecessors claim, but only in a secondary sense, and here I quote, insofar as it orders the acts of the other virtues to its end, that is, to move all the other virtues by command. Just as charity can be said to be a general virtue, insofar as it orders the acts of all the virtues to divine goodness, so also can legal justice, insofar as it orders the acts of all the virtues to the common good. Therefore, just as charity, which considers divine good as its proper object, is a certain specific virtue in accordance with its essence, so also legal virtue is a specific virtue in accordance with its essence, insofar as it considers the common good as its proper object. And so it is in the prince primarily, and as it were architectonically, and in subjects secondarily, and as it were administratively. Aquinas thus compares general justice with charity in order to explain the way in which it is associated with every other virtue. In its own sphere, general justice directs the other virtues by referring them to the common good, in somewhat the same way that charity directs every other virtue towards its proper object, that is to say, a certain kind of love of God. The key to understanding Aquinas' view lies in the claim that one virtue can order or command the acts of another. In his terminology, the virtues elicit their own acts, and they order or command the acts of the other virtues. This is so because the virtuous acts of the particular virtues retain their own integrity, as acts directed in some way to the formal object of the virtue. These virtuous acts can then be referred to a higher aim in such a way that the agent intends both to attain the specific good of a particular virtue and to achieve or safeguard a higher aim in and through this virtuous act. I realize this sounds abstract and maybe not too relevant, but we can readily imagine some examples which bring the point home. Here is one. A married man is tempted to have a little fling while traveling far from home. You know, nobody will ever know. What harm will it do? However, he's committed to his marriage and he is disposed to be faithful to his wife, and so he refrains. This act or non-act is most immediately an act of temperance. However, he also believes that affairs damage society, and being a just as well as a temperate individual, he chooses to be faithful for this reason as well. In this way, his temperate act is ordered to general justice while remaining specifically an act of temperance. Aquinas's point, therefore, is that general justice can be identified with general virtue in somewhat the same way as charity is so identified. Even though charity, like general justice, is properly speaking a particular virtue with its own proper object. At the same time, we should not press the similarities between general justice and charity too far. The theological virtue of charity is at least potentially proper to everyone, and it orders and commands all the virtuous acts of the charitable individual. General justice, in contrast, is a virtue which is centrally important within its own field of operation, but restricted in scope. Properly speaking, general justice pertains to the governance of a community. And as Aquinas goes on to say, it is an architectonic virtue because well-framed just laws operate in such a way as to direct virtuous activities of all kinds to the common good. That, he adds, is why it is also called legal justice. That is why it is primarily a virtue of political rulers and especially lawgivers. This is not to say that general justice has no place in the lives of private citizens, but that place is limited to a disposition to act in accordance with the laws and directives of the community's rulers for the sake of the common good. This point is worth underscoring. At some points, Aquinas strongly emphasizes the priority of common or universal goods over individuals' goods, in such a way as to suggest that the virtue consists in subordinating one's interests and desires to some collective good. Read in this context, the personal would be political comprehensively and without remainder. Yet when we examine what Aquinas says more precisely about the relation between general justice and the other moral virtues, we see that he spells out the terms of this relationship in such a way as to preserve the distinctiveness and the individual value of one's private individual goods. General justice can be said to command the acts of the other virtues for the simple reason that the laws can prescribe acts of any of the other virtues. It does not follow that every virtuous act is necessarily commanded by law, or much less that other virtues are morally significant only insofar as they are actually or potentially subject to legal regulation or otherwise referable to the common good. Beyond that, Aquinas simply observes that the overall good estate of the individual, including her overall virtuousness, contributes to the common good because the community is made up of individuals and their well-being is intrinsic to its good. Hence, if an individual acts out of temperance or fortitude in pursuit of her own private good, or if she aims at the good of some other individual through particular justice, her action is ipso facto directed to the common good, precisely because the latter includes the good of every individual. This does not mean that the act in question ceases to be an act of temperance, fortitude, or particular justice with an immediate orientation to some private good, whether the agent's or another's. The act retains its character as an expression of the particular virtue which elicits it, while at the same time it is directed remotely to the common good through general justice. On this account, general justice plays an important but limited role in the lives of private individuals, which is to say nearly all of us most of the time. I take it none of you is running for public office. Right, okay. Virtuous men and women go about their affairs in such a way as to pursue their own private goods in appropriate ways and to respect the justified claims of others. These activities are not normally motivated by a desire to promote the common good, However, men and women are aware that by acting in reasonable, moderate, and fair ways, they are promoting the overall well-being of their communities, and this adds an additional incentive to cultivate self-regarding and other-regarding virtues. Moreover, virtuous men and women are disposed to respect the law, and more generally to act in accordance with the directives of governing authorities. This might strike us as problematic, but it is important to remember that for Aquinas and most of his contemporaries, unjust enactments and commands are in fact not binding law. Of course, there's a lot of room for ambiguity and compromise between the extremes of mindless obedience and the refusal to accept legal authority at all. We might wish that Aquinas had said something about the place of general justice in the lives of citizens, insofar as they participate and rule through democracies or mixed states. Nonetheless, my point here is that Aquinas' emphasis on the legal aspect of general or legal justice reflects a wider account of the moral purpose of legislation, which in turn depends on his account of political rule and the common good. And this brings us to the virtue of general justice as it is instantiated in the just ruler. And so I turn to my second part, general justice, the overlord, and the prince. As we have already observed, Aquinas claims that general justice is most fully exemplified in a ruler whose actions as such are directed towards preserving and promoting the common good. This familiar claim may strike us as obvious, yet it was not obvious for Aquinas and his contemporaries. Power was problematic for them on both the theoretical and practical levels, and we need to take account of these problems in order to appreciate why Aquinas and his interlocutors were so concerned with the justification and the limitations of political rule. At the theoretical level, power was problematic for much the same reason that private possessions are problematic. That is, it runs contrary to the ideals of equality and freedom associated with natural law or natural right. I quote here, and this is a general catchphrase that occurs in many scholastic writings, "By natural right, all enjoy one equal status of liberty, and all things are held in common, but these things are changed through the law of nations." How can this reversal of the moral order be justified? For many of these profoundly Christian thinkers, the answer to the question was obvious. Dominion over persons and property is a consequence of sin, either as a punishment or as a way of constraining chaos, or both. Nonetheless, obvious though it might be to some, this line of argument struck others in this period as unsatisfactory. If institutions of power and property are the results of sin, then how can we distinguish better and worse forms of these pervasive social realities? What kinds of critical standards can we apply to fundamentally sinful ways of life? The circumstances of the time gave urgency to these questions. As the historian Thomas Bisson has recently argued, the 11th and 12th centuries experienced a troubling reassertion of claims to dominion, conceived in terms of personal dominion over servile populations. It is important to realize that this represented a reversion, deplored as such by those who experienced it. By the middle of the 11th century, communities which had only recently been in a condition of dependence or servitude were beginning to enjoy a new independence and freedom. To a considerable extent, indeed, the reversion to exploitative forms of dominion was itself a byproduct of the emergence of political institutions. The emerging governing authorities in Europe could only make their rule effective by means of subordinates, usually knights, commanding armed bands of fighting men and taking armed castles as their base of operation. These castellans, so-called, sometimes in collaboration with the governing authorities, very often not, took advantage of their position to impose their will on the population subject to them, exploiting them for financial gain without even a pretense of justification. Those unlucky enough to find themselves subject to one of these overlords found themselves once again reduced to servitude. Scholastic debates on power, authority, and political rule were therefore not just academic exercises. They had immediate implications in a society facing these threats to the liberty of its members. In response to the challenges of their time, jurists and theologians in this period began to argue for principled constraints on the exercise of power. After the rediscovery of a full range of Aristotelian moral and political thought, scholastics, including, of course, Aquinas, draw on Aristotle's distinction between tyranny and political authority. In order to draw a connection between legitimate power and a respect for the liberty of one's subjects. In the first part of the Summa Theologiae, Aquinas asks whether authority and subordination would have existed in paradise, that is to say, without sin. He addresses this question by distinguishing between two kinds of dominion. Understood in one sense, dominion is exercised for the sake of one holding power over another. This constitutes servitude, and it would never have arisen apart from sin. But there is another kind of dominion grounded in human nature itself, which is not inconsistent with the free status of the subordinate. And I quote, "Someone exercises dominion over another as a free person when he directs him to the proper good of the one being directed or to the common good. And such dominion of a human person would have existed in a state of innocence for two reasons. The first, because the human person is naturally a social animal. Hence, human persons in a state of innocence would have lived in society. But the social life of a multitude is not possible unless someone is in charge, who aims at the common good, because a multitude as such aims at many things, whereas one aims at one thing. Hence, the philosopher says that whenever many are ordained to one thing, there is always found one as the principal or director." We see here the central elements of Aquinas' understanding of the common good. Most fundamentally, it is understood by contrast to private good, or with the good of another individual or faction. As such, it provides the fundamental rationale for the exercise of political authority. By the same token, it provides a rationale for law, and it serves to justify the ruler in some course of action that would be close to private citizens. Finally, political authority does not compromise the free status of its subjects because it does not place one individual at the service of the private whims of another. Men and women are subject to political rule and legal authority for the sake of a greater good for which they are jointly responsible and from which they all benefit. Aquinas does not say, but his remarks imply that the benefits of a community include not only the material and social advantages of a shared life, but even more the structures necessary to enable and safeguard the equality and freedom of each individual within the community. Now, what does this tell us about general justice as a virtue? On Aquinas' account, a genuinely good, just ruler is characterized by a stable disposition to desire and pursue the common good, in such a way that she characteristically intends to promote the common good of the community in her legislative and directive activities. This much is obvious, given that the common good is the proper object of general justice. However, when we place this ideal in its context, we can begin to fill out the picture of the just ruler in such a way as to have some sense of her characteristic ways of reacting and acting in her activities as a ruler. The first point to note is that the just ruler is not an overlord. He does not dominate others without regard to their interests and desires, and he does not exploit his position to pursue his own private interest. This kind of injustice can take many forms, and unfortunately, we have seen most of them. At the most obvious level, graft, corruption, and the exploitation of one's office for private advantage are all contrary to general justice. This will not surprise you. Similarly, the use of power to take revenge on one's enemies and the use of force to stifle opposition and dissent would also be clear examples of injustice. I would suggest that the pursuit of political office as a way to attain personal glory or to gratify one's self-esteem would also be contrary to general justice. The pursuit of the common good is distinct from and may run contrary to the pursuit of fame, and glory can be seductive, leading men and women to act in ways that undermine the security of the commonwealth. At the same time, the just ruler pursues the common good in specific ways and observes constraints in the process of doing so. At this point, we begin to see what is distinctive and also perhaps controversial about Aquinas' account of general justice. The just ruler is not an overlord, but neither is she a political realist, in Reinhold Niebuhr's terms. She pursues the collective interests of her community, but she does not set the common good above every other consideration or pursue it by any means whatever. She is realistic about the ambiguities of power in a fallen world, thanks to her political prudence, but she is not a skeptic about the possibilities of moral action in the public arena. She desires to be just and restrained in her relations with other communities, as well as her own subjects, and she is unwilling to inflict unjust harm on anyone. Moreover, she believes that she can act effectively within the boundaries set by these commitments, and she exercises her political prudence in order to find ways to do so. In the exercise of her political authority, she is moved to act by a desire to promote and safeguard the common good, but only in such a way as to respect the claims of others, including, where appropriate, the claims of those outside the community, as well as the claims of her own subjects. By now, it will be clear that Aquinas' account presupposes both the theory of morality and an overall sense of the limits and possibilities set by the world we live in. Niebuhr, for one, would say that his views on political life are too optimistic or perhaps just out of date. Unsurprisingly, I would disagree with that. I will return to this briefly at the end of my remarks, but for now I want to focus on the wider context of constraints shaping a commitment to the common good, as Aquinas understands these. One set of constraints stems from the conception of the common good as the principle for political authority. Political rule is not dominion, and its subjects are not reduced to servility, because the ruler who aims at the common good acts for the sake of those he rules. This line of analysis implies that the common good is understood and pursued in such a way as to preserve the free status and the fundamental equality of each member of community. Of course, this general ideal can be interpreted in a lot of ways. Nonetheless, there are some obvious ways in which the political ideals of the common good can be compromised in the process of trying to safeguard common interests. In his discussion of the validity of human law, Aquinas observes that an enactment that imposes inequitable burdens is not a just and valid law, even if it otherwise promotes the common good. Even more importantly, the common good does not justify harming those who are innocent of wrongdoing, because, and I quote, "the life of the just conserves and promotes the common good, since they themselves are the most significant part of the multitude." Society exists for the sake of its members, and especially for the sake of those good men and women whose lives sustain the moral integrity of the community. At the same time, the just ruler is not only just insofar as she possesses general justice. Aquinas holds that the virtues are connected in such a way that anyone who truly possesses one of the principal virtues possesses them all. We would therefore expect a truly just ruler to have the other major virtues as well. Given our own recent experiences, this claim will immediately raise examples in your mind of people who fail in this with respect to sexual morality. We can talk about this, but I think this is the most complex and maybe the least satisfactory illustration of the point that Aquinas has in mind. Other virtues are more immediately relevant to general justice beyond the virtue of temperance. The most obvious such virtue is particular justice, which disposes the will to respect the rights of others. Aquinas claims that general and particular justice are distinct virtues, but they can also be interpreted as two interlocking ways of aiming at ideals of equality and freedom. All the virtues are connected, but general and particular justice are linked in a distinctively close way. They share the same general orientation and ideals, and they work in tandem to dispose the agent to relate rightly to other people and collectives. Recall that for Aquinas, particular justice is oriented to the right as its proper object. The governing ideal of particular justice is equality, which Aquinas interprets as equality of status or equal liberty. To the just man or woman, everyone enjoys certain fundamental liberties and can exercise basic claims for forbearance and aid. Taking his starting point from an offhand remark of Aristotle, he identifies what we call non-maleficence as offenses against commutative justice on the grounds that anyone who injures another deprives her of the honor that is her due. That is to say, as the context makes clear, the honor due to her as a human being. Aquinas is very reluctant to admit that it is ever legitimate to harm someone through direct injury, appropriation of goods, or verbal attacks. He argues that some seeming harms are not really such, and he offers a very qualified justification of forceful self-defense, but taken as a whole, his remarks on non-maleficence indicates that he takes the injunction not to harm the neighbor very seriously indeed. For the private individual, the distinctive ideals of particular justice are not likely to come into contention with his commitment to general justice. However, the virtues of general and particular justice might seem to be in some tension for the ruler. After all, inflicting harm is part of the ruler's job description, as St. Paul says in Romans 13:4. You remember the text, the ruler is a minister of God who bears the sword to inflict judgment on wrongdoers. Aquinas concurs with this general point, as I think all the scholastics do. There are limits to what a ruler can legitimately do in pursuit of the common good. Nonetheless, given that the ruler respects these limits, she can and sometimes must act in such a way as to inflict harm or compel obedience. Of course, Aquinas does not want to say that the ruler is exempt from the demands of particular justice. His point is rather that these demands take a different form for someone who inhabits a public role as a ruler or lawgiver. Someone who exercises political authority acts on behalf of the whole community and in the name of the community, and the harms that he inflicts in this capacity are not imputed to him as an individual. Rather, they are actions of the community executed through the agency of its authorities. In this way, the political ruler is similar to a judge who imposes penalties as a minister of the law and is therefore not culpable for the harms inflicted through the judicial process. Correlatively, the punitive acts of a political ruler do not violate the equal status of the one subjected to penalty. The one being punished is not being subjected to the will of another, but to the judgment of the community which the ruler represents. At the same time, I think it is fair to assume that a truly just ruler will bring a certain set of attitudes and sensibilities to his belligerent and hostile acts. One of the key elements of the disposition of particular justice is an aversion to harm, and it would seem likely that someone who is deeply committed to justice at every level will carry that aversion over into his activities as a ruler. Given that he is both just and prudent at the level of general justice and political prudence, he will not fail to carry out hostile activities when they are really necessary. But neither will he be quick to resort to force or eager to punish more harshly than circumstances demand. This brings us to another point that is again worth underscoring. The dispositions of general justice presuppose a willingness to act within the constraints of law, in accordance with the demands of a role. The punitive or coercive act of a legitimate ruler are justified in key part because they are in some way impersonal. Of course, these acts must be carried out by individuals, and they will inevitably bear some traces of the disposition of the rulers and their agents, for both better and worse. Nonetheless, one key component of general justice is a willingness to set aside one's private judgment and feelings in order to respect general and impersonal standards and processes. The just ruler acts in accordance with the laws, just as the upright judge respects what we identify as due process. The impersonal character of laws and legal procedures provides a kind of protective boundary between the rulers and subjects, protective on both sides. They safeguard the interests and the fundamental equality of those ruled, but they also preserve the integrity and humanity of the rulers. What is more, someone who is disposed by general justice to care about the ideals of a community may well come to value its just laws and procedural standards as themselves embodying the rational ideals which give the community its moral identity. Now, I think there's a great deal more, you can well imagine, I think there's a great deal more to be said about the relation between general justice and the other virtues. But let me break off at this point to turn to my conclusion, and perhaps we can return to these other issues in the question and answer. At this point in conclusion, I want to return briefly to an objection raised above. That is, it might be said that Aquinas' account of general justice and the common good is hopelessly idealistic and therefore dangerous in its moral pretensions. Our recent history makes this objection all too plausible. Our legislators and public officials do include decent, honorable men and women, but increasingly these seem to be exceptions to a depressing general rule. Our political institutions, which were once regarded as infallible safeguards for our freedom and well-being, have been taken over as instruments to promote factional and class interests. The ideals of ordinary decency, much less general justice, are not much in evidence in our political life. Time does not permit me to give this objection the full attention it deserves. Let me just say that while I accept this critique, at least in its main lines, I do not believe that the current breakdown in public life was inevitable. For at least 40 years, public life in this country has been marked by deep strains of hostility to government, to the constraints imposed by the rule of law, taxation, and financial regulations. Ronald Reagan famously captured this sentiment when he proclaimed that government is not the solution, but the problem. The political equivalent of the view that marriage is the enemy of true love, also very common in this period. It is difficult to say whether Reagan's view of government has ever been a majority view, but clearly he spoke for significant and powerful elements of our society, and the influence of these elements has only increased. For most of our history, at least since the Civil War, political disagreements took place within a context of shared commitments to the deliberative process and the institutional structures which sustain that process. But during President Obama's administration, opposition to his policies was expressed through attacks on the legislative process itself and on the structures of government that sustain rule. Again and again, factions within Congress attempted to shut down the government by suspending funding and refusing to act on presidential appointments. The president's own legal entitlement to office was called into question, repeatedly and in the teeth of evidence. It is hardly surprising that after 8 years of deadlocking government, the American public in desperation has elected a strongman who neither values nor understands the fundamental principles of constitutional governance. Given the widespread breakdown of the institutional norms and structures that sustain our political life, it is hardly surprising that Aquinas' ideal of political rule as a moral activity might seem hopelessly idealistic. Yet he himself would have predicted that the anti-governmental ideology that has dominated public life would have just these effects. Recall that on his account, the virtuous pursuit of the common good implies a willingness to act within the constraints of legal and political norms, to govern in the name of the community and on its behalf. Only in this way can a ruler govern without compromising the essential equality and liberty of individuals and the authority of the law. By refusing to accept these constraints, our rulers have undermined the very structures of government which make it possible for men and women to rule justly and out of a commitment to the common good. Our present difficulties were predictable, and they may well be irreversible. Nonetheless, we have a moral obligation to try to rebuild a just regime, and Aquinas' ideal of the just ruler who aims at the common good offers us some starting points for the difficult task we face. Thank you. Okay, Mark?
Yes. I wanted to ask about your understanding of Aquinas' way that general justice and particular justice are defined by their different objects. I think this proposal is going to be unsatisfactory, and I would like you to tell me why. But I noticed that in differentiating between particular and general justice, there's a certain asymmetry about their objects. One is the the object of particular justice is the rights or use or suum or something like that, and the object of general justice is the common good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, but you could put these in a more little symmetrical form by saying that, as they say, I believe this is Aristotle, or at least something in Aquinas, justice is the good of the other. So you could say that the object of particular justice is also the good, but of another individual. And you could say, or you could say that the object of general justice is not the common good, but you could say it's the right of the community. So what would in this case, what would distinguish particular and general justice would be particular justice is in governs a relationship with another person, the relationship governed by the right and the sort of further object being the good of that person, and general justice governs a relationship with the community and it's sort of particular governed by the rights of the community, so to speak, and the further object being the good. So rather than having one aimed at the good and one aimed at the right, that sounds rather Rawlsian, doesn't it? But anyway, you could have them sort of be more symmetrical, but the main difference would be simply individual versus community relations is what these two things are governing. And I'm wondering why that, what would be wrong with a scheme like that?
Oh, nothing's wrong with it. I mean, that's what Aquinas does say.
Okay.
If you look at the Secunda Secundae 79.1, when he's talking about the integral parts of justice, what has to be there in order for the virtue to be exercised at all. At that point, he does say that the object of justice is the right, whether rendered to the individual in particular justice or whether it takes the form of rendering one's due to the community, which is to act for the common good. So Aquinas wouldn't have a problem with that, but neither would he regard it as in any way undermining the distinction he's drawing between particular and general justice. It's just that the obligation to aim towards the common good is an obligation of right, in the sense he wants to set it up in the Secunda Secunda. Oh my goodness, okay. Let me go in this order. I saw it three hands simultaneously. And I can't see everyone's name, so excuse me. Yes, thank you.
Thank you for your wonderful and very clear paper. You focused on the virtue of justice, so
mm-hmm.
on the political dimension of common good. But Aquinas, in the Treatise of the Grace, says that the highest common good is God himself. And can you explain a little bit the link between these two dimensions of the common good? In the figure of the just ruler.
Okay, Aquinas says at different points that Aquinas is the highest common or general good.
That God is the
highest. Pardon?
We may regard Aquinas as the highest good, but God, Aquinas himself regards God.
Did I say Aquinas? Oh boy. Sigmund Freud, call your office. Sorry about that. Yeah, okay. So Aquinas thinks that God is the highest general or common good. That's certainly true, and it becomes important for Aquinas in certain contexts, mostly when he's talking about how the structures of motivation that inform the virtues reflect and can be put in a wider context of the kinds of targeted activity that we find at every level of existence. You know, everything is moving to the universal or general good, which is God, in its own proper way. Aquinas does not say that charity aims at a common good. He says charity aims at friendship with God. And at one point he says that one's ultimate happiness, which is the enjoyment of the beatific vision, could be attained even if no other individual were participating in it. So while God is a good that many in common attain, he de-emphasizes the common attainment. Do you see what I mean? And by the same token, when Aquinas talks about general, about the common good as the object of the general virtue of justice, I don't see much of anything in the texts in that links that in any kind of normative or interpretative way to the common good considered as some more general or universal kind of good. He's making a point here about structures of motivation. And the point he's making is that in order to act justly for the community, the will is moved towards the good of the community and not towards the private good. That doesn't commit him, and he doesn't really try to say much about what the common good would consist in, any more than at this point he's going to talk about what one's private good would consist in. The point is the contrast. Okay? Okay, Ben?
Yes, thank you for your paper. Two questions. One, does Aquinas ever speak about general justice as an infused moral virtue? And if he does that change or affect the account that you've just given? And then secondly, possibly related, not sure, does mercy come up in his account of general justice? And I'm thinking here, in particular, what you're saying about the end, towards the end, about the ruler, in a sense, mediates justice impersonally. But I'm thinking of, say, a governor who pardons someone on death row. Is that a personal or impersonal act? So how does mercy fit in his account of general justice?
Yeah, those are excellent questions. To your first, Aquinas doesn't specifically talk about general justice as an infused virtue, but he says all the cardinal virtues are infused with charity.
Right.
So presumably anyone, a ruler who has charity also has infused general justice. Now what's the significance of that for understanding general justice? I think there's a delicate point here. You can't give an account of general justice which would presuppose charity in Aquinas' terms, because you have to be able to say that there's an acquired virtue of general justice. But by the same token, Aquinas is going to say that the infused versions of the cardinal virtues are going to, how shall I say this, they're going to respect the natural exigencies and the rational structures which inform the virtue in any form. They're going to do this in a different way, in a higher way, in a way that's oriented towards a different formal object, and therefore they have a different mean. But they still are going to respect the same kinds of basic, you should pardon the expression, premoral exigencies that inform the virtue in any form. Otherwise, the infused virtue would be a perversion of natural faculties rather than their perfection at a higher level. So general justice at any level has to be not inconsistent with charity, even when it's not charitable. Do you see the point I'm getting at?
I think so.
Just as acquired temperance cannot be inconsistent with infused temperance, even if it's not going to be aimed towards the same formal object as infused temperance.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and that means that if you reflect on what it means to live the life of virtue and charity, it tells you something about the virtues at any level.
Uh-huh.
And I think what that means, and what's particularly relevant in this context, is that general justice operates within constraints which includes certain kinds of activities or attitudes towards those outside the political community. It includes some recognition of the claims of humanity as such.
Uh-huh.
Now, I would think more immediately about ruling out things like torture or other egregious violations of common humanity. For Aquinas himself, I think this becomes relevant in the discussion of principles governing warfare. Even with belligerents, there are certain things that you can't do because there are certain claims that humanity as such puts on you.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't thought very much about mercy and its implications, but I think you make a really good point. That is to say, again, at any level, general justice has to leave some space for the activities of mercy. And I think the activity of the judge who is merciful, or the political ruler who is merciful, I know presidents also grant pardons, is a good example of a point I tried to get at and just sort of went over very quickly. The just ruler acts within constraints of an office, but there's always inevitably some space for personal dispositions and judgments. And so something of the private man or woman is going to come through in the exercise of office. And I think that that can very well include some exercise of mercy or restraint or compassion, you know, so long as these are not done in forms which downright contradict the lawgiver's or the judge's responsibilities. And so this will be one of those examples of a case in which the public and the private aspects of the individual acting together in tandem, both may well be on display. Does that sort of get at what you're getting at?
Yeah, it does. I suppose maybe what I'm wondering about is does that example of mercy press a little harder the idea that the personal, in fact, is political? That's sort of what I'm wondering about. And
I think the personal is political up to a point and within constraints. Okay? I mean, let's just dice our rhetoric here.
Yeah.
You hear some modern discourse on the common good, and you can take away the impression that the whole point of human life lies in its orientation to the common good. Now, this usually comes with a very sort of juiced up account of what the common good is. But there's a very clear tendency here to deny the moral significance and in some cases the overriding significance of private goods and individual claims. And all I want to say is that Aquinas doesn't take us there. I think he does allow and in some ways would demand us to say, you know, the personal is political in other ways. And we can talk about what that would look like, and you've given a good example of that.
Thanks.
Father Edmund.
Yeah. My question is also kind of on the personal and political. You made this contrast between the virtuous king and the functionary.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like in our times, the functionary is someone who remains agnostic about what the true ends are and just keeps a framework. And it seems like in that sense, St. Thomas's ruler is not a functionary. That is, we were looking yesterday, Mehmet Çiftçi showed us a text from the Treatise on Law where Aquinas says law is ordered to common happiness.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems like there you have, it's not just what people happen to desire, but it's their what's actually good for them, so that the ruler, if his subjects desire the wrong things, he can order them to what is really their good, rather than what they happen to desire. And that way he's more than just a functionary the way we would understand it today.
Well, you know, I think the great invention of the Middle Ages is bureaucracy. I mean, I'm not kidding about this. This is their solution to a lot of problems. And it worked pretty well. I mean, the medieval schools were bureaucracies, and they were training people. The church was a bureaucracy. The emergent political authorities and rules were bureaucracies. The systems of offices with defined claims and duties were very important. It was important that people were able to enter into offices and to act in ways that involved setting aside private judgment. And there was a moral point to that. And it was a complex moral point, but part of it, and I think the larger part of it, was that this was the only way they saw to preserve the possibilities of exercising power and authority in such a way as to respect the due claims and the equal status of their subjects. Now, that being said, does this mean there's no room at all for consideration of any wider context of goods? Well, every human being makes some judgment about his or her ultimate good and sees his or her activities as a functionary as playing a part in that. I mean, that's a given. And if someone considers that exercising public office is inconsistent with his salvation, then obviously he ought to leave public office. you know. To what extent does the legislator take account of the ultimate good of his citizens or of the community? Well, first of all, a community doesn't have an ultimate good in the same way. The law is directed to the common happiness of the community. That means it's good a state and functioning as a community. You know, the community isn't going to get saved. Does the lawgiver respect the ultimate salvation of the individual? Well, that depends on whether the lawgiver is the prince or the pope. Really. Church law does have the salvation of the individual as its ultimate aim, as it says to this day in the Code of Canon Law. But that's outside the remit of the state. And Aquinas, he's part of a long tradition here. He has a lot of very interesting things to say about the extent to which the state does or does not have a stake or indeed a right to try to make its individual subjects moral. So I guess my overall point would be that in the mindset of the time, what you have is a morally justified system of setting aside certain kinds of moral judgments at certain points in order to preserve other moral ends. I think that's inevitable in any sort of functioning legal or governmental system. And at any rate, I think that's what we've got, to the extent that we have a functioning government at all. A couple of people, let me turn to you first, since you haven't had a chance yet, and then I'll turn back to you.
Thank you. Thanks for an interesting conversation. So you just thinking sort of more practically on the political side of things, and the end of your paper, what you discussed about we have an obligation to build a just regime. And you stated that Thomas's theory is not hopelessly idealistic. And so my question to you is, like, so what? How do we know how to build a just regime, or how can we come to an agreement on how to build a just regime? And you can probably see the question comes, right? How do we know how to do that when the source of a lot of the gridlock and differences are grounded in very different conceptions of what the common good in social and political life consists of? You have people on various sides of, you know, various divides who have very different sort of worldviews that leads them to very different conclusions about what political and social life ought to look like. And so how does Thomas, how can his theory inform us in a helpful way in trying to navigate these sorts of disputes and seek the common good together?
Well, I would say a couple of things. Obviously, you can't say everything that you would want to in a context like this. The first thing I would say is that the most important takeaway from this for contemporary thought, at least as I see it, is that the political climate, as we call it, and what we think of as inevitable limitations of governing activity, the moral structures of government itself, we tend to speak as if these were givens. And therefore we face a situation in which moral activity at the political level is either impossible or at least very, very difficult. And the first point I want to make is that we're neglecting the fact that we have created the world we live in here. And the structures of our political regime and the norms that govern our political life aren't just givens. We have a certain moral responsibility for these. So that's the first point that I think we take away. The second point, and I think this is a contribution more from the scholastic world generally than from Aquinas himself, is a very strong focus on the moral value of the rule of law and on what we call broadly constitutional structures. The scholastics as political thinkers give a lot of attention to the ways in which power is exercised and the ways in which different centers of power fit together. I mean, these are the classic constitutional questions. And I think we still can learn a lot from their theories of law and their theories of political order. mostly about the kinds of constraints that need to be in place in order to allow people the kind of space they need to exercise their claims of right. There are things we cannot learn from this period, and I think it's just as important to recognize that. The scholastics, as far as I've been able to tell, have very little to say about what we would call, and again, terminology is going to confuse us here if we're not careful, what we would call distributive issues. Questions having to do broadly with the just functioning of markets and the appropriate degree of equality or inequality in the allocation of resources. They do have some interesting and important things to say about the origins and the limits of property, but not a lot about these sort of distributional and economic and structural issues. And there I think we have other resources to turn to and should turn to them. In terms of the overall question of how do we rebuild Washington,
just a small question.
A tedious argument of insidious intent leading to an overwhelming question. Oh, do not ask what is it. Let us go and pay our visit. I mean, we can talk about this more later, but, you know, probably at this point I should turn to some others.
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Sure. You wanted to jump back
in. Yes, just a remark about democracy. How can you explain that disciples of Aquinas have finished the regno in a very theocratic way, if you say that democracy is an invention of Middle Ages and above all of Aquinas?
Oh, I don't think that democracy is an invention of the Middle Ages. Oh, good heavens, no. It goes back to the classical period, at least. Aquinas is very persuaded, and you're going to see this at many points in his writings, that good rule implies ideally one ruler. That's why he takes the position he takes on the papacy, and that's why he tends to speak in terms of the values of a good king. Now, when you look at what he says in the Summa Theologiae, when he talks about the ideal regime, he says, well, if we were completely virtuous, a king would be the ideal ruler. But given that we're not, the best form of rule is mixed rule. And he says this in defense of the old law in the Hebrew Bible. He says, so you have here an element, elements of all the different kinds of the constitution, of constitutions, and that's best. To take Aquinas as either an inventor or a defender of democracy, no. Now, what he does defend very strongly is an ideal of equality and what he calls free status. But free status, the status of the liber, implies a zone, what you might call a zone of personal freedom. It doesn't necessarily imply what we would call a freedom of participation in rule. Or universal suffrage or anything of that sort. That's a different set of concepts that you don't get here. And not everything good comes from Aquinas. Even he's not the highest good. He's very, very good, but he's not the highest good. I think we're probably out of time.
On that note, thank you, Jeannie, for your talk.